I thank the Holy Spirit for using you and preparing the atmosphere for what we are about to discuss this evening. Thank you very much. God bless you. Have a seat. As I consider the state of the world, I cannot help but wonder where we're heading. The world is in such turmoil that we wonder how much longer we have to be on this earth. Natural disasters have overtaken us even more than in times past. Hurricanes, earthquakes, tornadoes, volcanoes, droughts, fires, name it. Man-made disasters are just as prevalent. Global warming being the most threatening right now. We have nuclear spills like never before. We have wars like never before. The world is in such turmoil that it gives us cause to just pause and wonder about what Jesus said about the last days. And in the midst of all of this chaos sits the church. And so my objective tonight is to put into perspective the place of the church in the scheme of all that is going on around us in the world, so that we will truly know where we stand as the body of Christ. We will truly know what is our stance with respect to our relationship to God. And so I've chosen for my topic tonight, the called. The called. The world refers to us as the ecclesia, the called. Because we are indeed separate, peculiar. We stand out in a world of chaos and ruin as a people of peace and assurance and comfort. God has promised us peace in the midst of all the storms that face us. But ecclesia is not just another word. It's a word that means a lot of things. The called in Greek has various shades of meaning. And for every meaning, there is a Greek word. For instance, if I were to name something and say, this is a book, then called, this thing called book in Greek, called there will have a particular Greek word. If I were to beckon you, to summon you, to come, I've called you, there'll be yet another word for called there. But the word that is used in Romans 8, I think it is 28. It's a very popular verse of scripture. It says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to the called, to them that are called according to his purpose. Called there in the Greek is yet another word, which does not mean the same as when you name something or when you beckon someone. Called there is kletos, K-L-E-T-O-S, which means appointed. So our call as a body is not an ordinary call, but is a call that is specific to some purpose. We very often think, quite erroneously, at least I used to think that way, that we found God, but nothing is further from the truth. The truth is that it is God who found us and called us, because the scripture says that even while we were sinners, Jesus died for our sins so that we can be reconciled to God. So God, all this while, had a plan for us. God, even before the creation, called us. He did not only call us, but even while we were in the transition to answering that call, because many of us had a life very much unlike the ones we are living here today. We had a life that was steeped in sin. I had, at least, a very sinful life. In fact, there was a time in my life when I never thought that I would ever be a Christian. I had vowed never to go to church again. But God did not only call us, but He used His Holy Spirit while we were in that sinful state to keep nudging us towards Him. So that every time we committed a sin, the Holy Spirit faithfully convicted our hearts and made us recognize that we have done something wrong. The only ones that don't have that experience are those whom the Holy Spirit have given up to a reprobate mind. For as long as when you do a wrong, you feel that sense of guilt, rest assured, God has not given up on you. So He calls you. He keeps calling you. Until we get to that place where we are now. He did not only remind us of this or bring to our consciousness the sin we have committed, but very often He has saved us from being grievous harm to ourselves. Very often when I look back on my youthful life and I think about the reckless things I did, I know that it is only the grace of God that has kept me unto this day. I still recall the days, and I very often tell about them, when I used to have to travel sometimes about 200 miles from one point to the next during the course of my work. And I remember the days when I used to do that in a little over 2 hours. 2 hours, 10 minutes, 2 hours, 15 minutes. Now, that was the height of recklessness. But I was just a young man then. I was in my late 20s, early 30s. I remember the days when I went to places like the Kaichou Falls. That's the highest sheer drop of water in the world. 741 feet. Straight drop. Went on a picnic, and in my youthful exuberance and the need to show off, decided I'm going to walk out into the fall to the edge of the water, walk out about 6 feet, and look down, looking over the fall. And then that voice said, "What are you doing? Suppose the next step takes you right over the fall." And I just stepped back. I mean, when you sit and you think back on those days, it has to be the Holy Spirit that has been keeping, because even since then, God had seen the day when I will stand here. When each of us would be here in this place. We are never here by accident. God said, even before we were conceived in the womb, He knew us. And He had an appointment for us. So, we have been called not just to be here, but we have been called for a specific purpose. Some of us have been called to be apostles, to establish churches and to bring order to the church, to the body of Christ. Some have been called to be prophets, to hear and speak the mind of Christ. Some have been called to be pastors, to look after the sheep, to keep us fed with the word. Some have been called to be evangelists, to be the sheep dogs of the flock, to make sure that we go out and gather those who have gone astray. Some to be teachers, so that we can be edified in the word. Some to minister in other areas, like music, singing, hospitality. But we have all been called for a specific purpose. But in all of this, we have also had another calling. In the midst of all of this specificity, we all have a common calling. And that is, we are called to have a particular kind of relationship amongst ourselves and with the world. And I am strongly persuaded that notwithstanding our call in specific areas of the church, of the body of Christ, if we are found failing in the general areas of our calling, that is with regard to our relationships within and without the body of Christ, then our effectiveness in the specific areas of our calling will certainly not yield much fruit. It's like a doctor. If before you can effectively specialize in any area, you have to be knowledgeable of the general areas of medicine. It is no different in the body of Christ. If you're going to be effective in the specifics of your calling, you have got to master the general areas. And so, this is the area that I would like us to focus on very briefly. Musicians are not long talkers, so I'll get straight to my point. But I feel it is important that you know what we need to do in terms of our relationship within the body of Christ and outside of the body of Christ, our relationship with the world. The crowning quality of our relationship within the body of Christ is love. Love. God set his disciples in Matthew 13:34-35. He said, look, I give you a new commandment. As I have loved you, you also love one another. And in doing so, all men will know that you are my disciples. So our very first obligation in the body of Christ is love for one another. And believe me, that is the area that we grapple with the most. That is our greatest area of difficulty. That is our greatest area of challenge. But do not be deceived. We know why this is so. Because unless we really are firmly grounded, which area do you think will receive the greatest attack? To distract you? To disengage you in that which you ought to do? To make you do that which is contrary to your calling? The area of love. So, consider it not strange that although we are called to love, that we struggle so much with love. But I have the assurance that God has said that he will never give us any assignment without giving us the means to do it. So if God has called us to love, it means that we are capable of loving. And if you find yourself failing, don't ever believe that you are done for. If you fail, you have to do like the song says. Pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and start loving all over again. You can never go wrong. So love is the first area that we really need to pay very close attention to in this body of Christ. I don't have to tell you what love is. If you read the Bible, you'll know more than you'd ever want to know about love. I can't tell you what love. You know scripturally what love is. You've heard it preached so many times. But as Jesus had to admit to his disciples, very often, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak, and so we fall. But don't be discouraged. You keep on striving. And once you do, the Holy Spirit will give you the enablement to achieve that which he has asked you to do. But I know we cannot cover all the areas with respect to our relationships in the body of Christ. So I should like to turn briefly to a part of scripture in 1 Thessalonians 12, verses 12 to 22. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, sorry, verses 12 to 22. And it says, we urge you, brethren, and this has to do, I'm saying again, with our relationships in the church. We urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Recognize those who labor among you, those who are placed above you, those who are in authority over you. Do not despise them when they admonish you. Because even God says in his word that whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. If I claim to love you and I will not correct you, then I really don't love you. Because my desire for you to do the right thing should always be more than my desire to please you. I'd rather know that you stop talking to me forever, but you leave my company saved from that which would have befallen you. Because it would only be a matter of time before you sit and reflect that, oh, he was right. Many of us never enjoyed the licking we got as children. But I've heard many adults say, at least those of my age group, I know you people today don't flock children because it's against the law. But in my day, flogging was indeed the rod of correction. We never enjoyed it. But many of us live to confess that if it were not for the sternness and discipline that my parents imposed upon me, I would never have been where I am today. So, when your leaders in the church admonish you, don't hold it against them. The only reason they will do it is because they love you. They want to see you do right. Goes on to say, be, of course, esteem them highly always. I mean, you've read that, but I need to mention that. esteem them highly. In fact, the Bible says that we must always strive to esteem our brethren, esteem others more than ourselves. Always lift up your brethren. Never feel that you are greater than they are. Always feel that they are there for you to serve them. Always esteem them greater than you are. Much more so those who are placed in authority over you. Be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn those who are unruly. Warn those who are unruly. Those who are not susceptible to correction. You know, there are times we are tempted to say, I've had enough of you. You will find out your error sooner or later. The Bible doesn't admonish us to do that. Because if we do that, we shall be responsible for what befalls that person. Warn those who are unruly. Never fail to admonish them. Comfort the faint-hearted. We are not all strong in the faith. Some of us have weak minds. Some of us are easily influenced, and we can be easily led astray. We must always encourage them. If they fall, comfort them. Don't ridicule them. Don't pour water on a drowning man. It's bad enough if you're in the body of Christ. You know what you ought to do, and you've fallen down. You know, you the Bible says sometimes we know what we want to do, but we find it difficult to doing. We know what we ought to do, but we find it difficult doing those things which we know we ought to do. Sometimes even the strongest of us fall prey to that kind of circumstance. We can all fall. We all have frailties as human beings. So at some time or the other, we are all faint-hearted. We have our weak moments. We should comfort one another. Uphold the weak. Be patient with all. I hear the But I tell you this. I mentioned it before when I was up here. It takes a lot of patience to deal with church people. In church and out of church. I have had many church people working with me. And believe me, some of my best subordinates were those who were not Christians. Now, outside of the body of Christ, we can do anything. We'll pay for it, of course. But in the body of Christ, we cannot. Because God says that not all of us will be punished to the same measure. If you know what is right to do and you don't do it, you'll be penalized more than those who don't. Everybody is getting the same measure of punishment. So while I might have done, or while a man in the world might do that and suffer some punishment, if you do the same thing in the body of Christ, our punishment will be much greater. We have to exercise patience with our brethren. Don't give up too quickly on them. They will try us, they will try our faith, our patience, our tolerance. every fiber in our body. But we have to keep encouraging them. We have to have patience with them. Oh, sometimes we may fly off the hook, but we have to quickly come to ourselves, repent, and do the right thing. See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone. Now, I don't expect people in the church to do that, but you know what? You know who Paul is talking to here? The people in the church. He's not talking to those outside. He's talking to us. See that you do not render evil for evil. Now, it is ironic that you have to say that to people who are the called. But like I said, we are flesh. And the Bible says that we must not have faith in flesh. The arm of flesh will always fail. So see that we don't render evil for evil. If somebody does something bad to you, don't hold it against them and wait for the chance to do it back to them. Oh, I've seen it so many times in the church. But I must confess that I've seen it far more in the churches that claim to be holier than thou. I've seen even officials in the church who sit and wait for someone to fall so that they can deal with them. But I can't say too much about that, because I haven't been to too many churches, and you may know about whom I'm speaking, so I've got to be very careful. But always pursue what is good, both for yourselves and for all. Now that sort of sums up how we ought to deal with those among ourselves. Now, the world. How should we treat with the world? I'll give you a shocker. Love. Love. The same cardinal principle that governs your relationship within the body should govern your relationship with the world. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Why did he have to give his son? Because the world was very sinful. But he loved the world. So we have got to relate to the world in love. Jesus told the Pharisees, when they asked him about the great commandment in Matthew 22, 37, he said, the great commandments are two. One, love God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And two, love your neighbor as yourself. Your neighbor is not necessarily those who sit next to you in the pews. You know the story of the Good Samaritan. Love your neighbor. So we have to relate to the world in love. We do not like what the world does to us sometimes. But whether they hurt you, they despise you, they ridicule you, you are commanded to love them. Jesus said you must love your enemies. Because he says it's simple. What will set you apart as the called? Jesus said, if you do good to those who do good to you, what makes you any different from those people in the world? He said, they will do that too. But if you do good to those who hurt you, that will set you apart, because the world generally does not behave that way. So firstly, we have got to look to the world in love. We are called to be light and salt in the earth. We are called to high standards of godliness and morality. We are called to be leaders and not followers. But you know what? Very often, we find that the role is reversed. It is the world who leads the church in a lot of things. And what is laughable, again, I know of a church, when they do all the things that the world does, when they follow everything that the world does, they say, well, what we're doing, we're taking back, because the devil didn't create anything. Therefore, we're taking back what the devil stole from us. Believe me, they say so, and they believe it. And so, I've been to church concerts where they come up, saints come up, and they sagging and doing their rap and things like that. And, well, you know, I'm old-fashioned. When I complain, they say, well, who created dance? The devil didn't create anything. The devil did not create anything, but the devil adulterated everything that was created. Everything he put his hand on was adulterated. So if you do what his children do, then you're not doing what God would like you to do. You're doing that which is tainted. Anything the devil puts his hands on is no longer holy. So when the world comes out in fashion and we try to outdress the world, we are being followers of the world. Now, we've heard this spoken time and time again. But believe me, I have been to some places where I was embarrassed to look at some of the brothers and sisters in the church, especially when there are funerals and weddings. I'm talking about saints. I've known of many instances where the pastor refused entry to some saints who wanted to come to church to attend a wedding dressed in a certain way. The excuse was that that was the style that was given them, and since they are part of the entourage that has to go with the bride, then they cannot be different. I've known of pastors who have accepted them. I've known of those who said, well, they will have to come with one bridesmaid short. But generally, in the world of fashion, the fashion hardly hits the market. And the Christians are jostling even straight with the world, irrespective of the type of fashion, to get in line with the fashion. I'm not saying that we must be old-fashioned, But I'm saying you can be fashionable yet modest. If to be immodest is the only way to be fashionable, then I say don't be fashionable. Because you're not, when we in the fashion, you know who we're pleasing? Believe me, our intention is not to please God, you know. Our intention is to look good to others. So whom are we pleasing? And if you're going to sacrifice pleasing God so that you can look good to people and you still say you're a Christian, then you need to have your head examined. We cannot follow the world step by step in everything they do. Some things are acceptable. We should look good. But we should not look lawless. The Bible says that if ever we do anything that will cause the brother to stumble, then we are committing a sin. Even if the thing we do is good, he says all things might be good, but all things might not be expedient. If whatever you do will cause anyone to stumble, refrain from doing it, no matter how much you would like to do it. If you find if you dress in a certain way, you're going to cause problems, don't dress that way. I know, for instance, the way we dress over here. In many of the churches in my country, it would not be acceptable. It does not mean that you will go over there and say, well, look, this is the way we dress, and offend your brothers over there. That is not godly. That is not godly. I saw a documentary the other day where some natives in some country in Africa went to France, and they were 80, almost 90% naked. And they went into Paris, they went into the best places. It was a movie that was shot. And they came maybe to the preview or whatever, I don't know. They were invited. And they came in their native apparel. Now, they were properly dressed, because that's the way they dress. If you have a church there and those people go to church like that, you cannot tell them they're not properly dressed, because they're not offended by the way they look. When Adam and Eve were in the garden, they were stark naked, but they were not offended. But if what you do will cause offense to your brothers in the body, then don't do it. In our music, at one time, the going thing in my church, it doesn't happen as much over here, but in my church, over there, about 40% of the songs we sang had melodies taken from the songs of the world. And at one time I wondered whether it was not just an excuse to enjoy yourself in the church like you used to enjoy yourself in the world. Because sometimes when we sang those songs, the big girls in the church, we used to dance in the old days, and you play the song and they start to, and they hold on and they closing the eyes. And I'm wondering whether they're closing their eyes to worship God, or whether they're reminiscing on those days when they were in the world. I really don't know. But they really did enjoy those songs that were, the words were changed. They maintained the melody. They maintained the beat. And they enjoyed themselves in the church. And of course, again, when that was spoken of, they said all music was created by God. So any music we play is music unto God because he created it. And we ain't singing no bad words. But you see, I'm always reminded that God, man looks at the outward appearance. God looks at the heart. Okay, there may be nothing wrong. I cannot judge you. But what I know is that if perchance your motive for doing that is wrong, then you'd better repent. If your motive is wrong, I cannot say that singing songs with melodies of the world is wrong, because there's nothing impure about a melody. Absolutely nothing. It's just that the behavior of those who were singing and celebrating those songs gave me the impression that they were reminiscing on some things that were not very godly. God forgive me if I'm wrong, but that was the impression I got. So we must be careful. There's a thing that is current today, and that is the topic that is of great concern, particularly in the developed world: homosexuality. Now, there was a time when the church frowned on homosexuality. But you know what I've been finding recently? Many churches are finding convenient interpretations in the Bible to justify homosexuality, to the extent where they're so convinced that even the church leaders openly espouse homosexuality. But that did not start in the church. It is the church that is following the world. We are called to be leaders and not followers. We ought to set the tone. We ought to set the standard for godliness and morality in the world. We are not to follow the world. The thing that is most hotly debated today is gay marriage. I'm sure you have seen, as I have, that there is gay marriage in the church, from the pulpit to the pew. Bishops, gay bishops, got gay wives, sorry, not wives, gay partners. You know, we are not to follow the trends of the church. Church administration is following the way of the world. Today, a pastor's tenure in office is dependent on the vote he gets at church elections. Today, a man can only become a bishop if another man lays hand on him and says, "You are no bishop," or "You are no evangelist," or "You are no apostle." It's no longer a gift from God. It's an endowment by man. Today, man tells you that the rules that are made by the church supersede the rules of the Bible. I saw a documentary involving the Seventh-day Adventists where a man was excommunicated, not because he flew in the face of the commandments of God, but because he did not obey the rules of the church. We are called in the world to set the tone. We are called to godliness and morality. We are called to be leaders and not followers. Let not the world direct our actions. Let us tell the world what it ought to do. If they don't want to do it, fine. Because remember, we are not supposed to be in the world. We're supposed to be of the world, but not in the world. We are supposed to be a people set apart, a peculiar people. If you behave like the rest of the world, there's nothing peculiar about you. If people can look at you and see that you are special or different in some way, then there's something wrong with you. Anytime you are so much like the world in terms of your behavior and the things you do, then you need to stop and take stock of yourself. God said that you ought to be different. People must look at you, look at your lifestyle, and see that you are different. And different in a good way, that they will want to follow you and do the things you do. Do not be led by the world. Let us look at 2 Peter 5:10. I think I will allow the scriptures to do the wrapping up for me. 2 Peter 5:10. Where is that? Yep. 2 Peter chapter 1, sorry. Verses 5 to 10. Yep. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. Add to your faith virtue or moral excellence, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, to kindness to brotherly kindness love. So at both ends of the spectrum we have faith and love. For these things are yours, and what? They're not scarce, they abound. So don't, the Bible is saying, don't say you can't find these things, these qualities. They abound. You will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. We are the called. We are the ecclesia. We have a role to play in the midst of all that is going on in the world. We must be that oasis where people who have come to the end of their tether in terms of their suffering, they must see an oasis where they can come and find peace and comfort and encouragement and godly love. The church must always be a place to which those who are out there, who have reached the end of the line, can turn for restoration, can find themselves in the right place. If we do these things, if we follow these precepts, then people will see our good works and will glorify our Father who is in heaven. Let us think on these things. Let us be whom God called us to be. God bless you all.